Are you tired of all the voices who say, focus on the bottom line numbers?
Say whatever you have to, just close the sale.
Just get the credit card. It doesn't matter what you deliver.
You will never build a successful business until you grow a pair and stop caring so much.
Here, we respectfully disagree. We give you permission to embrace who you are, how much you care, and encourage you to design a business that works for you and your clients. Welcome to The Art of Giving a Damn, the podcast that proves with every single episode that you can create a profitable business doing what you're passionate about and making a positive difference in the world. Now here's your host, Michelle Schaefer.
Hey, welcome back for another episode of The Art of Giving a Damn. Today, my guest is Tom Leahy. Tom, thank you so much for being on the show.
Well, thank you for having me. I really look forward to it.
I'm excited because I think you've got a very different perspective on something that's a hot topic right now. So just as way of intro here, you are the co-owner and managing partner of a company called Optimum Ed. And over the past 2 decades plus, you've been helping families figure out college planning.
Right.
And let's start with, how did you get into that?
Okay. Well, it's kind of interesting. Actually, when I retired from the Army, I got into financial services, became a financial advisor. But almost immediately, I was in front of some parents that were asking me to help them with things that I really couldn't help them with. And that was, you know, can you help us fill out these financial aid forms? And how are we going to pay for college? And I said, well, God, you know, that stuff wasn't on the exam, you know? So I started, you know, looking around, started doing research. And the more I looked into it, the more intrigued and passionate I got about higher education and college, understanding as a wealth manager how devastating college costs can be to a family if this higher education thing isn't done correctly. Even back, you know, 20 some years ago was still an issue. Today, even more so. And if we don't address it and do it right, it can be devastating financially for the family. It can be devastating for the student in terms of being unmarketable and finding themselves in a non-degree job, earning minimum wage, and all of that. So yes, so that's kind of where it's over the years. As I was in wealth management, I created a company on the side that I coached kids through this process. And it was all about having a value proposition. You know, we need to get an education, true, but we need to do it as efficiently as possible. And so 7 years ago, I sold my wealth management practice to do this full time. That's how passionate and how important I think it is that we provide families and students a way to make better decisions, you know, about their future.
Absolutely. One of the things that caught my attention when I looked over your website, some of the things that you're involved in, your books and things, is you have a different perspective on how to plan for all of that, because I know so many people who've gone to college and they're not doing anything related to their degree, or they got out of school and realized they didn't have the right experience or whatever, and they end up working at McDonald's or somewhere like that, or trying to figure out their own business. So talk to me a little bit about that process and how you guide people through that.
Yeah. Well, we have, our philosophy is a little bit different, and I think it really, today, parents, as a society, we need to embrace what we see as a paradigm shift in higher education, and that is the end game is no longer the degree. The end game is a job and career that degree and major deliver, right? And I want to make sure people understand, I'm not saying that college doesn't have value. It does. But, you know, what are we trying to achieve, and is it necessary to spend $100,000 or more for that educational leverage, depending on what direction you're going in terms of the industry, the job that you're going to be successful at. So it really is a question of what should you be when you grow up as a student, not necessarily what you want to be. There's a difference, right? What should you be? And what does that look like in terms of education and training? And then where do we go and get that education and training? What is the best fit school for the student? you know, not just big, little, urban, suburban kind of stuff, but it can be very specific, you know, because the happier the student is, the better they'll do. And, you know, the sooner they'll get out, because one of the big drivers of cost today for families, aside from the escalating tuition and fees, et cetera, is the fact that we don't graduate on time, right? Well, yeah. About 20% of students nationally are graduating in 4 years.
That's what I saw.
Just over 50% in six. Yeah, it's crazy. Even more important is that 30% of first-time college students are dropping out in the first year.
That statistic was startling to me.
Yeah, we're not planning ahead of time. Used to be we could afford to send our child off to college to find themselves and flail around and figure it out. But for most families, we can't afford that anymore. So we've got to do better planning up front. Ahead of that expenditure. And so our process is built to greatly increase the chances that, you know, the money that mom and dad are spending and the time and energy that the student is spending in higher education is going to result in that return on investment. And then again, I go back, it's not the degree, it's the job and career that degree and major deliver.
That makes a lot more sense to look at that from that perspective of, okay, what's the career you actually want to have now necessary and kind of working backwards from that? Because I mean, education nowadays, it's more than people invest in their homes. It's more than, you know, you spend on something
exactly.
else. It's a degree.
Yeah. And you walk away with student debt. It's like, yes, like buying a home, but not having the home. Right. Yeah. And so, everything we do starts with a career and academic assessment. This is not something you can find online. We contract with a very large company to use their Pathway Planner product. This is where it starts. We spend a lot of time in talking about the results of the assessment and what that means in terms of direction. Because if we do a good job there, as I described before, the rest is planning backwards, right? So we'll spend 5-6 hours in that place and with that assessment and the results. And it's, you know, it looks at aptitude, it looks at behaviors, personality, it looks at interests. Those things come together to create a profile that we then marry up with jobs that people with a similar profile are actually doing. And then we can, you know, investigate those jobs. We can do the research on, you know, digitally out to the website, to O-Net, to, you know, is this job growing or declining over the next 15 years? How many job openings are available in the state that you're living in each year? You know, there's only 4 jobs available. Well, maybe we need to take your passion in a different direction that has a little more potential. So, you know, it's all about really having as much information as possible, make the best decisions so that when we get in, we're not changing majors 2 or 3 times. We're not changing colleges. We're getting in, we're getting done, and we're getting out. Being efficient.
That makes a lot more sense than what it seems like is kind of the standard these days, which is you pick a school based on location or size or sports teams and then end up changing majors repeatedly. What advice would you give parents whose kids are maybe going into high school, tail end of high school even, that are really looking at this conversation? And where do you start that conversation with your kid?
Well, I think it's about understanding a couple things. One is to, you know, let them explore and discover what's out there in terms of, you know, the job options and career options, right? Don't try to pigeonhole them into something you think is right for them, okay? Because sometimes parents are too close to it, right?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I can tell you, you know, when I was, it hasn't changed much. You know, when I was growing up, I was going to be the first family doctor, right? It was medical school. I took care of medical school the first semester I was in college. That wasn't going to happen. Organic chemistry kicked my butt, right? So, you know, so we need to understand our child's strengths and weaknesses and also understand that there's more to being successful than academics, right? That's why there's things that part of the college application that have nothing to do with academics, right? Like, you know, your high school resume, what have you been doing besides studying, you know?
Right.
What are you bringing to that college campus other than your GPA and your test scores? Are you going to step on campus and be a leader? You know, what is it that, you know, campuses are little communities. They want to be diversified. They want to be robust and have a lot of different things going on. So we have to paint this holistic picture of a really quality, not just student, but an individual that is going to really bring something to the to those colleges. And that's part of being competitive.
Mm-hmm. So really looking at what's not just what's the career that fits the kid, but also what are you putting in place to really look good and bring value?
Right. And that's going to follow them through college and into employment, right? Because, you know, you think about what employers are looking for today in terms of attributes, right, in a new employee, you know, and it's those things that aren't learned out of a book, you know?
Yeah.
So parents have to keep that in mind, too. We have to help our kids develop, you know, those characteristics as well as have, you know, that learning piece. So, and that's all what we can help coach kids and families with.
Huh. What are the challenges that you usually see as you go through this process with clients when you're working with a family where, you know, the parents are generally the ones in charge of the payment part of it,
right,
and the kids coming in and benefiting from that? Yeah. It leads to, I'm sure, sometimes some disagreements or some challenges. What do you see in that process happening right now?
Well, it's all, you know, every family is different. Every student is different. So while we have a process, it is customized for each student. But, you know, we like to say we manage expectations, and we manage information, and we manage the process. So expectations are a huge part of that when they come to the table, that initial conversation and coming to an understanding as to what we're trying to achieve and what is right for the student. You know, just because your son has a great 3-point shot, you know, basketball, that, you know, 6'1" skinny white kid may not be playing Division I basketball, you know, but that – so, you know, it's, I mean, I'm being facetious, but you get the idea is that we really have to understand, you know, and what, you know, what realistically what we can expect and what is right in terms of fit for our child, and then help them, you know, realize that.
Got it. So how do you feel about, and this is a conversation that I know I'm sure you've had with clients and others before, a lot of people kind of look at it like they're not sure college is worth it, given how much it costs and the opportunities that are out there. Where do you fall in that particular discussion?
Well, our assessment of where is where it starts, and our assessment process will bring that to light as to whether college is appropriate or not for the student. We just recently got a paid apprenticeship for a young man with a local electrician, right? We've got another student who's working for a local Class A contractor, and a young lady who is getting a certificate in display merchandising, and she's working on a display team for Macy's. So, that's, you know, cool. It's not just going to college. It's about finding a way forward and what's appropriate and right for you. We've got a young man who's out in Denver at Johnson Wales learning to be a chef, and you know, every story is different.
So the focus really is on what's the career that's going to be a good fit, and how do we set you up for success.
We want the child to be fulfilled and successful, and sometimes that's not, you know, that's not college. A lot of times it is, but you know, sometimes it's a different path. And so we're all about finding that path. We start with a blank canvas, and we paint the student's profile. And, you know, that takes us forward.
Oh, that is such a different approach than most of what's out there. That's gotta be rewarding to see on the other end of that, when the kid comes out of whatever that process is for them, with something they're excited about.
Oh yeah, to see the excitement on the student's face when they get accepted to that school and that program that, you know, they weren't sure they were going to achieve. You know, that's wonderful to see a young man who is struggling because of, you know, learning disabilities or something, finding that he can actually be productive, learn, and do something good, you know, on a construction site and that sort of thing. You know. head held high, knowing that they have, you know, have something to give back, you know. That feeling is so gratifying as a coach and a consultant, as a therapist sometimes. Yeah.
I'm sure you end up wearing a lot of hats, from coach, consultant, therapist, mediator.
Right.
I can imagine that process gets a little interesting.
Yeah.
What I love about that the most is I really do believe everybody is here with something that they can do, something that they're meant to do, that they can give back and deliver value. And when we force everybody into the exact same pathway, it just doesn't work well. People end up thinking they're not good at anything.
Right.
We just haven't found that thing yet.
It's the old trying to cram a square peg in a round hole, you know, doesn't work.
Absolutely.
And, you know, even trying to shave the edges off of that square peg so it'll fit doesn't really work. So, you know, it's finding, if you got a square peg, find a square hole, right?
I like that. If you're a square peg, find your square hole.
Square hole, right? Yeah.
What's been the most interesting part of this from a business perspective for you of building this business kind of on the side and then making that decision?
Launching it, yeah.
Enough of the wealth management, this is what we're going to focus on. What was that part like for you?
Well, I mean, obviously it was kind of scary. When I told my wife that I was selling my wealth management practice to do this full time, she checked with a couple of attorneys to see if I could be committed. But that didn't work out. So, you know, 7 years later, here we are, having helped dozens of kids find their future and find happiness. And sometimes it is a challenge in terms of, you know, like, I mean, just from a business standpoint, you know, budgeting against inconsistent cash flow and some of those things that you get involved in as a, you know, when you're in small business. But at the end of the day, when I can put my head on the pillow knowing that I have really made a difference in a young person's life, there's nothing like that.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Well, that leads me to a question that I ask almost everybody when I do these interviews, and that is, what is your favorite part of what you do in business?
That, what I just described, you know, to know that we've made a difference in a young person's life to help them find a way forward, and to see the joy on the parents' faces that their son or daughter is achieving something and has a path and is going to ultimately achieve the goals that they've set for themselves. You know, that's what makes it all worthwhile. Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, I'm glad you didn't end up committed. That had to be a tough conversation.
Yeah, right.
Looking back at all of that, is there anything you would have done differently in the process of kind of transitioning between those businesses?
Well, you know, we're sort of what we call it a disruptive brand. So, you know, everything we do is an experiment, right? So we never know until we try something whether it's going to work or not. You know, so looking back, I can, you know, hindsight is 20/20, right? I can look back and say, gosh, we shouldn't have done that, or, you know, if we'd have done this, you know, a little differently, things would be, you know, a little better here or there. You know, there's always those kind of conversations you have with yourself. But no, I don't think I would have changed anything in the journey. You know, it's all been really exciting and gratifying.
So you brought up something interesting there about being a disruptive brand, and you definitely are. I mean, like, the messaging that you guys are putting out there and the approach you're taking to it, that's not normal. That's not what most advisors or kids going into college would even consider saying to them of, wait, first minute, back up. Let's figure out if this is the right path for you.
Right.
What has that experience been like for you? Do you find that the industry is pretty accepting of it, or is it pretty tough to be that disruptive in your space?
It is, you know, that's interesting you said, you know, I was talking to, Amanda Team, who works with me. She's been with me now almost a year, and, you know, she was concerned that she didn't have an education background. And I said, you know, Amanda, having an education background would probably be a detriment to what we're doing, because it's a different mindset,
right?
Right. And are educated, wonderful people. I love them dearly. But, you know, to them, education itself is the end game.
Right.
And it's a bigger question than that today for our young people.
Absolutely. Yeah.
There has to be.
It has to be a bigger question and a bigger conversation.
Right. Yeah.
The more viewpoints you can bring into that, the better it is for everyone.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. I think, and if I could, I don't know if you can see that. Everybody's got a book, right? There's my, we just published, Plan for College, Prepare for Life, No Nonsense Guide to Higher Education. Be checking the website. Occasionally we'll have a link there to the publisher. We're having our celebration next week. I'm not going to call
it. So it's brand new.
Yeah, brand new. Well, actually, it's like the fourth edition. Every time I republish it, there's something new in it. So.
Awesome. Where's the best place for people to go to find out more about the book itself, and then to find out more about you?
We're planning on putting a link on the website here shortly. Okay. So as I said, just keep checking back to the website, and there'll be a link. I hope in the next few days. To take you to the publisher where you can order it. If you're just can't wait for that, you can always email me at tleahy@optimamedcenter.com and ask for a copy, and I'd be happy to mail one to you.
Okay. So it's optimamedcenter.com.
Optimamedcenter.com. And on there, on that webpage, there is a free college readiness assessment that students can take. And if you do that, then it also provides the parents with a half hour conversation with me to really talk about, the parental things that are you ready for your child to go to college?
Cool. All right. So wherever you are watching or listening to this podcast, you can go to optimamedcenter.com to reach out to Tom, have that conversation with him. And while you're there, take a look at Tom's YouTube channel. They've got some fantastic videos that walk through a lot of the questions that I know parents and teenagers have about this process. So you'll want to pop over there and subscribe as well. Tom, thank you so much for your time today.
Yeah, I just want to point out, too, that we can do this for anybody, anywhere, through video conferencing. So you don't have to be here in Richmond, Virginia, to take advantage of our process and our philosophy. So thank you.
Enjoyed it
immensely.
Absolutely. It's always a great conversation when I'm able to talk to someone who has that different perspective and they're willing to own that, stand up and be disruptive in their industry with it. So thank you for what you're doing to give kids and parents a little different approach that sounds like it's getting them much better results in the end with that big
goal. We think so. Thanks so much again.
Thank you. Wherever you're listening or watching the podcast today, be sure to hit like, rate, review, and subscribe. And we will see you back again soon for another episode.